Have you ever asked yourself, can I injection mold with a 3D printer? Well, I have, and even though this might sound stupid in the beginning, there is more to this than you might think. 3D printing is great for rapid prototyping and low volume production, but there are certain applications where you can only use injection molding, or where you want or need the details and strength it can provide. Industrial injection molding machines and molds are very expensive. So what if you could use the tools you already have at hand to make a low volume run or a proof of concept for a design? I want to print injection molds on a resin 3D printer and use the extruder of a 3D printer to inject the plastic into it. Yet does this even work, and can this combine the advantages of both methods? Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video is sponsored by KiwiCo. Get 50% off your first month by using the link below. So, I wanted to try injection molding with a 3D printer. I have a ton of 3D printers, but no mold to inject plastic into. A very simple injection mold is a hollow form with a negative shape of the part that you want to make. It has a sprue where the molten material enters the mold, and it can be opened for demolding. So I went into Fusion and started designing one. I already made some pre-considerations, and one of them was the size of the mold, or rather the part that I could make. I often characterize the performance of a 3D printer hotend by its melting performance in cubic millimeters per second. Regular old V6 style hotends can usually melt up to 15 cubic millimeters a second using a 0.4 millimeter nozzle. Increasing the length with, for example, a volcano hotend can get you to maybe 25 cubic millimeters a second using the same nozzle. If you increase the nozzle diameter, add a high performance CHT nozzle and up the temperatures a little, you can get up to around 40 to 50 cubic millimeters a second. My famous test hook has a volume of almost 13,000 cubic millimeters, which would take around 256 seconds or over 4 minutes to fill even with such a high performance hot end. That's not only impractical, but also unfeasible. So big parts are out of the game for my idea, and I decided to scale down my hook to 35%, giving me a volume of only around 500 cubic millimeters, which I'll be able to fill in hopefully 10 to 15 seconds. So the mold I ended up with is really simple. It's split in the middle and has a sprue on the top where I want to inject the plastic and four of these metering pins for easy alignment of the two sides. I added two slots on the side that will allow me to pry it open when it's stuck together really well. The part that I want to injection mold is simply cut out with a Boolean operation. And if you enter the mesh workspace in Fusion, you can do that with any STL you have and don't necessarily need a CAD geometry, which makes the process quite simple. Regular injection molds in industry are usually made from high-strength tool steel, so they don't wear out over thousands or even millions of parts being produced with them. Yet working with tool steel isn't something that you can usually do in your home shop. But who knows, maybe I could do that in the near future if I get my hands on the open source EDM I recently covered. Yet for our purpose at the moment, this would still be overkill, because I want to make a proof of concept of whether my idea even works. So we'll print our mold. Formlabs recently provided their new Form 4 resin printer for some projects here in the studio, and I thought this would be a perfect opportunity to show its capabilities, especially with the materials they offer. One of them is called their 10K resin, which is a glass reinforced material that can withstand high temperatures and is a good 5 times stiffer than most other resins. This is important because we'll need to firmly clamp the mold together so that the plastic doesn't seep out the sides. After a good 3 hours of printing, cleaning the parts with isopropyl alcohol and curing them at 70 degrees Celsius under UV light for an hour, they were done and felt really good. The glass filling and the matte texture almost made them feel like a ceramic. So I got a 3D printer and now also a mold, which means we can finally start. But before we get to injection molding, a quick word from today's video sponsor KiwiCo. Every month, KiwiCo delivers a crate full of exciting STEM projects to your door that inspire your kids to explore, build, and create. KiwiCo has 9 subscription lines tailored for all ages and interests. Our 4-year-old daughter currently receives the koala crate and she's always thrilled when a new box arrives. Each crate contains everything you need for the project, so there's no need to make a last-minute trip to the hardware store. Building KiwiCo boxes with my daughter is a fantastic bonding experience. I love seeing how much fun she has in putting everything together. KiwiCo boxes are designed by experts, and you can see the thought and care they put into each one, whether it's a farm-themed game, a walking robot, or a basketball trash can. Every box not only contains the building manual, but also a magazine that lets you and your kids dive deeper into the project. If you want to see the joy in your kids' faces and watch them develop skills and a passion for making and exploring, I highly recommend checking out KiwiCo's subscription boxes at kiwico.com/cnc. And the best thing is, you'll get 50% off your first month if you use code CNC on checkout. It's a fantastic gift to get kids away from the screen, or you might even find a treat for yourself in KiwiCo's store. So check them out, and thanks to KiwiCo for sponsoring this video. So let's get back to injection molding. I first wanted to try this on a very typical 3D printer and chose my Prusa Mark IV. The Prusa has a relatively short hotend, so in its standard configuration it is not able to melt more than around 15 cubic millimeters a second of material. In order to increase its performance a little, I installed one of Bontech's CHT nozzles, which due to its internal geometry is able to at least double the melting capability. By also increasing the nozzle diameter, we decrease the pressure loss in the nozzle, which should allow us to press the plastic with even more pressure into the mold. Let's do the first shot. I loaded some regular PLA into the extruder. Then I clamped the mold with screw clamps in order to make sure that no plastic can seep through any of the gaps, causing flashing on the parts. I heated the hot end and then started to inject the plastic. After a short while, I noticed that the PLA was leaking out of the side of the sprue. This could either mean that the mold filled up all the way or that the mold got blocked quickly. Opening it was very underwhelming because the plastic barely flowed into the cavity. I cleaned the mold, slightly increased temperatures, and tried it a second time. The viscosity of a plastic decreases when increasing the temperature, so it gets thinner in consistency. This thinner consistency should help to fill the mold at the same pressure. I again had plastic swelling out of the side of the nozzle, even though I properly pressed the nozzle onto the mold. The result was better than on my first try, but it again only partly managed to fill the mold. When you want to 3D print really fast, you not only need a hotend that can melt all of the plastic, but at some point the small nozzle orifice becomes so restrictive that it gets hard to push the rather thick plastic through it. Yet we have seen more and more high-speed materials coming to the market recently trying to solve this problem. That's why I loaded Polymaker's Polysonic PLA into the Prusa and gave it another try. There was again material coming out of the sprue, but the result was another step forward with around 40% of the mold filled. I continued varying the ejection speed and temperatures, but the results did not really improve. I thought switching the filaments might help, so I tried out ASA, but that did horribly, and even PETG, which usually flows really well, barely made it into the mold. So this first try wasn't a huge success, but why would we even want to injection mold using a 3D printer? Quite frankly, price and accessibility. An industrial injection molding machine costs $10,000s or even $100,000s of dollars. Yes, there are affordable small-scale hobby machines, but even though I have a ton of equipment in my studio, an injection molding machine is not part of them. 3D printers have been becoming so common and inexpensive that it would be awesome to use one of them for small-scale injection molding or a proof of concept. I would love to injection mold filament samples to test them against my printed counterparts to find out how the strength differs. 3D printing is great and has a ton of different materials, but it lacks details on small parts and suffers from layer adhesion problems. Resin 3D printing, on the other hand, can produce small and detailed parts, but it struggles, for example, with flexibles and has its material limits as well. So DIY injection molding could do small and flexible parts, or even overmolding parts, which can't be done with either resin or filament-based 3D printing. There are certainly even more applications, and I'd love to read your ideas in the comments. So let's try to make this work. I think we have several issues that need to be tackled. First, the molten plastic cools down way too fast during the process and basically solidifies before it fills the complete mold. Formlab's 10K resin is totally fine even above 200 degrees Celsius. So I simply set my GD Q1 Pro to 120 degrees Celsius bed temperature and placed the mold on the bed. While it was preheating, I changed back to the high flow PLA because it was the material I already had the best experience with. After around 30 minutes, I took it out of the chamber, clamped it together, and started pushing the plastic into the mold. This time it took a bit longer until the plastic seeped out of the sides, which was a good sign. After letting it cool down for a bit, I tried opening it by hand, but it was sticking together really well. So I used the flathead screwdriver to pry it open. This was the best result so far, with almost the whole mold filled. Yet I think at this point we have reached the technical limit of the process. In order to fill the mold completely, we would need to increase the injection pressure, which is basically how hard we can push the filament into the mold and out of the nozzle. A while back I tested different extruders in order to find out the strongest one, exactly for this process right here. Most of them were able to push with a force between 6 and 10 kilograms. Using the cross section of the filament, we can estimate the injection pressure. At an average maximum force of 8 kilograms, the 1.75 millimeter filament is able to create pressures of over 300 bars, or almost 4,500 psi. This is actually significantly more than I expected, yet since we don't have a perfect seal between the nozzle and the sprue, we won't reach these pressures because the material is pushed out the sides before that. Anyways, even if we reach the 300 bars, at least according to my search, we are rather at the low end of injection molding pressures, usually used in industrial machines, which causes problems when filling the mold. If the 300 bar is the problem, honestly, I don't believe it. Or the non-perfect seal is something that I can really judge at the moment. But both are not that easy to fix. Or do you have ideas? The other problem is simply the melt rate of the hot end of the Prusa. Increasing the temperatures and installing the CHT nozzle helped, but in the end there is a physical limit we can't get around. But as I initially said, there are longer, better performing hot ends out there, which give the material more time to properly melt and hopefully also get into a state where it's viscous enough to flow into the complete mold. Yet before we build the Über-Hotend, let's simply exchange the 3D printer. This right here is my Pioppoli Magneto X, which is unique for its linear motors on the X and Y axis, but it also comes with a really long high flow hotend. Mine came with a 0.4 mm nozzle, which is probably way too restrictive for our use. Since I don't have any Volcano CHT nozzles, I used one of the Volcano adapters that we also sell in our shop and that lets you install any regular V6 nozzle into a Volcano length hotend. So I tightly screwed in the adapter, followed by the 1.8 mm CHT nozzle. Then I tried out this setup. I already noticed, because of the hard time that I had to open the mold, that the first shot wasn't that bad. Still, I was a bit upset that I didn't get that much further than on the Prusa. To fix the sticking issue, I also sprayed the halves with some mold release and continued adjusting the parameters. And after a bit of tweaking of the temperatures and the injection speed, I got this. Not 100% perfect, but almost, and honestly quite a success because I didn't even preheat the mold. Even though the hook kind of symbolizes my channel, it's a bit lame to show what we can do with injection molding. So I took my Mini Me figurine and made an injection mold from it as well. This one is a bit more complicated because due to the complex geometry, there's no straight parting line which wouldn't leave me with any undercuts. Having an undercut-free mold is essential to later be able to remove the part without breaking it or the mold itself. Any undercut will result in a deformation of the part when you remove it. Parts for injection molding are even designed in a way that you have small draft angles on the vertical surfaces that make demolding significantly easier. And you'll find them on almost any part. If you know about this, you won't be able to unsee this, trust me. Anyway, so instead of a plain cut, I drew a spline infusion and used that to cut my mold in half, which should leave me with almost no undercuts. Whereas manufacturing such a mold in metal would be quite a task, printing it out of resin is no harder than a flat mold, and it again turned out great in the 10K Formlabs resin. Since the volume of this part is a little higher, I adjusted my G-code and did the first test, which took a tiny bit longer. There wasn't a lot of material pushed out the side of the nozzle, which was already a good sign. Opening the mold was exciting because it looked as if it was easily able to fill the whole cavity and even the tiny footholes. I was a bit impatient and demolded the part a little early, which not only deformed it because it still was a bit soft, but also showed me that my almost no undercuts model still had some undercuts, and I was sure that it would have been a pain or even impossible to demold a fully solidified part in PLA. That's why I switched over to the material I anyways wanted to use for my mini-me, which was flexible TPU. Even though flexibles can usually not be extruded as fast, the Magneto handled it really well and produced a perfect mini Stefan on the first shot. I was honestly really impressed about the details I was able to reproduce. Also, the next parts went flawlessly, and it was really interesting to see how the material contracted when it cooled down, sucking a hole into the sprue. Also, my hook, which was really hard to make in PLA, turned out perfectly in TPU. I got a bit too brave at this point and tried holding the mold together with just my hands, which showed what flashing is and why a rigid mold and clamp is so important. As a last effort, I finally wanted to build my Über-Extruder. When I was at the Rocky Mountain RepRef Festival this year, I got the HE50 hotend from Takoto, which doesn't only have two ultra-long heating cartridges, but also a nozzle that is really long and should give us optimal melting performance. I designed a mount for an LDO orbital extruder and installed everything on a spare tool plate that fits my tool head test rig printer. This, of course, was easily able to fill the small mold with TPU, but I designed an even bigger version of my mini Stefan with a lug on the top for a keychain. And even this one filled beautifully, left me with an awesome DIY injection molded part, and nicely showed what this process can do. As a last project, I wanted to try overmolding, and I have already designed a mold that goes over a hex key. Yet, due to time constraints and technical difficulties, I wasn't able to finish that before the video went live. If you are interested in the results, follow my Twitter or Instagram, where I'll post pictures once I have tried it. Because I was curious, I switched back to PLA and tried this simple mold of an M4 screw that I made, but it had severe problems filling this one again. I played a bit around with the parameters and got a working screw out of the mold, yet never managed to fill the hex. Maybe the injection pressure of a 3D printer is here the limiting factor, or our 3D printing material grades are not suitable for injection molding. At this point, I also stopped working on the project for now. So the key takeaways are, a high flow hotend is very crucial. Preheating the mold helps, using the right type of plastic is important, and a high injection pressure is needed for complex molds. And we got the process working for small parts. Yet, do you think it makes sense to continue refining it? And how would you approach this? Please leave a comment down below.
Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you found this video interesting. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon or become a YouTube member. Also, check out the other videos in my library. I hope to see you in the next one. Auf Wiedersehen and goodbye.
Then I clamped the mold with screw clamps. With Swiss glue clamps.